Senate in Ottawa, good evening. The Senate in Ottawa has now passed the back-to-work legislation for the ports in British Columbia. And that means that sometime tomorrow, about 12 hours after the royal assent, everybody's got to go back to work, like it or lump it. And we'll be dealing with that tonight in some more detail. But first, here's Steve with the rundown.
Sylvester Stallone, eat your heart out. Tonight, Webster enters a subterranean world of professional boxing, and in the process provokes a premature confrontation between Olympic medalist Dale Walters and Canadian champion Tony Pep. Also tonight, how to keep a family together in the 1980s. In the studio with Webster, Virginia Satir, internationally renowned family counselor. But first, day four of the lockout on the waterfront, as Ottawa follows through on its promise to legislate an end to the dispute. Tonight, the deadlock is seen through the eyes of the Vancouver Port Authority and its spokesman, Ray Purdy.
Last night on Webster, we had an official of the I.L.W.U. stating quite bluntly that the famous or notorious or infamous de-stuffing clause about containers on the waterfront was not Vancouver's biggest problem in any way, shape, or form. Tonight, I've got Ray Purdy, who is Director of Port Promotion for the Vancouver Port Corporation. So let me put it to you very bluntly. Do you agree with the ILWU that this benighted de-stuffing of containers on the waterfront is not a major handicap for Vancouver?
No, I totally disagree with what has been said by the union that it is a handicap to Vancouver, because in our opinion, from the Port of Vancouver standpoint, it is the greatest inhibitor of our ability to be able to sell and promote this port and increase the number of containers and the hours of labor and the benefits that derive to the community from that.
How many containers did we miss last year or this year because of this clause?
Well, in sum total, there were 86,000 20-foot equivalent units that moved through the American ports to and from Canada in 1985. And I suspect that that volume this year will probably be closer to 100,000, some of which is attributed to lines that do not call at the Port of Vancouver, but a very, very large proportion of it is related to the clause and requires to move through those ports because of the de-stuffing off dock.
Now, as I understand it, freight forwarders, Canadian freight forwarders, assembling cargoes, we'll say, in the Orient or wherever they come from, will deliberately bring their containers through Seattle-Tacoma because it's cheaper, faster, and more efficient for them than to bring them into Vancouver and have them de-stuffed on the waterfront.
That's correct.
And that's a simple explanation.
Very simple.
Can anybody argue with that explanation?
I don't believe so.
Reasonably.
I don't believe anybody can argue against that.
So we can just say quite simply that many of the 80,000 came from freight forwarding agents who put them to Seattle, one, because they're getting deals from the Americans, and two, because they don't have to de-stuff on the Vancouver waterfront.
I'm not sure about the deals from the Americans, Jack, but certainly the de-stuffing on the waterfront.
But you mentioned shipping lines, for instance, and the Americans aren't stupid, and they'll do all they can to attract Canadian freight forwarders.
Absolutely, they will.
Now, let's go to legislation right off the top. This legislation imposes a wage settlement of some kind, and much in line with the Larson report, and then it imposes down the road sometime binding arbitration, which will also become law, to solve the de-stuffing. Am I correct in that?
Not really arbitration. The minister will appoint an industrial inquiry commission whose report will be submitted to the minister on or before the 30th of June 1987, and the content of that and those recommendations will then be translated into a collective agreement, which will become into effect either on or shortly after the 1st of September 1987, depending on whether it's practical for the minister to do so.
But it's now clear that the de-stuffing business is going to be solved arbitrarily on the recommendations of the Industrial Inquiry Commissioner.
That's correct.
That's good. Are you happy about that? That's June and then next September. Do you think the government has acted quickly enough or efficiently enough?
Like the idea, Jack, of the termination, the fact that it will ultimately be resolved, but I guess we're extremely disappointed that it will take from now until June and from now until September, effectively, to get anything operational when all of the parties, who are involved in this issue already have fully developed and expressed views, and it would have seemed to us that a much shorter time frame would have been more practical. We have grave concerns that some of our clients who come here now and have been tolerant while this issue was being debated will not stay with us.
Until the solution. In fact, I could say without fear of much contradiction that this issue of de-stuffing has been studied ad nauseam to death.
Correct.
But finally, the government's done something. They're just too slow in imposing their solution.
That's our view, that it could have been handled with greater dispatch.
But for the sake of the ILWU, may I point out that I've been trying to follow the story for at least 10 years. Nobody would ever talk to us about it. They all brushed you off. We all knew it was a thorn on the waterfront. And everybody, including the union and the maritime employers, hid their heads. And this is a clause that was put in not by the union, but by the employers. Correct?
That's correct, Jack. And if one turns its time back and goes back to the time when it was implemented, I guess there were benefits to be derived on both sides of the fence, and it was really never anticipated that the kind of diversion through U.S. gateways would have taken place to the extent that it has. But it's outlived its usefulness, and I think now is the time to change it.
And if the parties can't agree, somebody else has got to change it for them.
That's exactly what's happening.
Now, what about the other disadvantages? We all saw the hurrah when Huntingdon and all this new Tory Port Authority took, whatever you call it, corporation, Ports Canada was formed. But what are the other handicaps which you have not yet tackled to make Vancouver a better port? And I'm thinking that I'm always told that Seattle-Tacoma is much better, they have many more cranes, their productivity is much better, and we're a bunch of bums.
Well, Vancouver has not got as many cranes as Seattle and Tacoma, nor is Canada populated to the same extent as the United States. We have one-tenth mm-hmm. of the population, and it's quite likely that cargo flows in and out of the United States are likely to be at least 10 times greater than they are here. And as far as the productivity is concerned, Seattle can have its 21 cranes, Tacoma can have its 10, Vancouver has its 5, but the 5 that we do have are not being fully utilized. There's much greater capacity potential in those cranes than we have. This year we will carry through the Port of Vancouver something in the vicinity of 215,000 to 220,000 20-foot equivalent units. And we could, with the current terminals, with the current terminal handling equipment, and with the current cranes, handled somewhere between 300 and 325,000, or in other words, we have much additional capacity, much more capacity to fill.
We don't need more cranes. We need more containers.
We need more cargo.
And if we get these 80,000 or these 100,000 back, or most of them, you can handle them.
Yes, we can.
Now, what about autonomy? It's always been said that our ports are a kind of lackluster, illegitimate child of Ottawa. Does that still exist?
With the new act that came into effect in 1983 and the formation of the Vancouver Port Corporation in July of that year, local autonomy was provided for in the act. And we have clear indication of local autonomy in the fact that the board of the Vancouver Port Corporation are all local British Columbians. They are representation from the transportation mm-hmm. industry, from the labor industry.
But what
as a matter
money?
Of fact, your friend Jack
Monroe he's on
is on our board, mm-hmm. fully representing labor. And I would point out that Mr. Garcia served on that board from its formation in 1983 until last November. Mm-hmm. And had the opportunity during that time frame to be fully familiar with what this board does.
Back to the things in the back of my mind. Montreal gets all the money, we don't.
That's not true either, because we retain all of our earnings for the Port of Vancouver.
But
and
have
for
we
the
enough for any capital investment we need?
We have funds for capital investment, yes. And if we haven't got sufficient, then of course we have the opportunity to borrow from those sources that are approved to us.
Fair enough. Ray Purdy is the director of port promotion for the Vancouver Port Corporation, and he's going to take calls on the shipping problems in Vancouver and the government's actions after the break. you watch Webster long enough, you learn a little bit about everything. Wait to hear this question from the back of my incredible ubiquitous knowledge. One of the big advantages the Americans have, of course, is that they can double stack these containers on their rail, on their trains. And we can't because of the tunnels and the Rockies.
That's not true, Jack, because the Canadian transportation systems, both CN and CP, have the capability of moving double stack equipment. The difficulty with implementing a double stack system is volume related. To run a 220 40 foot equivalent train on a weekly basis, say between here and Toronto, turn the train around and come back, one would have to have 45,000 20 foot equivalent units to keep that train full.
Oh, you would only do that when you develop the business.
That's right. We must have the business to
be able to create. And that reduces the costs.
That's right. We must have the business.
But CN ships a lot of its containers out of Seattle on American rail lines. Is that not treason?
I don't think they
ship
a lot.
To Chicago? And then from Chicago up to Toronto?
I don't think they ship a lot. We know that there is leakage, and we believe that leakage through all of the American ports, just not Seattle and Tacoma, yeah, but also the California, is around about 20,000 20-foot equivalents on an annualized basis. And that's not all CN. That's Norfolk and Western, Conrail,
fair
and
enough.
CN.
Let's go to the calls. Go ahead, please. Hello.
Good evening, gentlemen.
Good evening.
My concern is the competition with the Americans. We can't compete with them with their 31 container cranes in their Seattle area compared with ours, and the backup area they've got is much bigger than we'll ever have, and they've got the public, the local public, investing in their future. We don't have that opportunity. We're in the city. We can't There's nowhere to go. There's nowhere to put these little ships. Big ship comes in and there's nowhere to put the containers.
Okay, here's your answer.
We have a great deal more capacity, really, to handle containers within the Vancouver Port Inner Harbor. With additional shoreside equipment, we can increase the volumes through this port in excess of the 400,000 20-foot equivalent mark. When we believe that that mark is being developed and coming close, we have a great deal of land, as everybody is aware, still sitting at Roberts Bank to be developed, whether it's developed for bulk cargoes or whether it's developed for further container capacity would depend totally on the demand that we have at any given point in time.
What did the caller mean? I'll ask you about local investment. Tax-free municipal bonds or something?
Well, what the Port of Seattle has, Jack, is that they have the right to tax their residents. The port has the right to tax their residents up to 3 mils. And last year, the Port of Seattle raised something like $23 million
out of local taxation. We'll skip over that one. Go ahead, please. Hello.
Hello.
That's you.
Yes, I'd like to ask Ray Purdy. I am a I.L.W.U. Longshoreman member, and I'd like to ask him, what's going to happen on the container de-stuff, and where are the cans going to go once they are de-stuffed?
Put down your television sound. Carry on.
I'm not sure exactly what you mean, but I think that if what you're talking about is once the container de-stuffing clause is removed, some of the work which is done on the waterfront may well gravitate to off-dock unless the waterfront unions are competitive from the standpoint of total efficiency in the distribution and cost side. From the standpoint of the exports, which are now being loaded into containers and creating the labor on the waterfront, I believe that a great deal of that will still be retained on the waterfront because it's more economic to do it today with the rules that are currently in place. And I suspect that it will be as economical to do it in the future.
You're talking about stuffing containers to go on board ships.
That's correct.
But coming off, the freight forwarders won't de-stuff on they'll go to their own place.
Yes, they will.
Cheaper labor rates.
But they do it now, Jack. They do it now.
Through Seattle.
And the boxes come through Seattle, and the waterfront labor in Vancouver does not get the time and the hours and the employment from those boxes.
Go ahead, please.
Yes, it's my understanding that the union down in the States indicated that they have a de-stuffing clause there. And also, it seems to me that what we're really talking about is contracting out, aren't we?
Not really. We're not contracting out. What is done on the waterfront is done on the waterfront by the union. What is done off the dock in Vancouver at the moment is done off dock, and the cargo moves through the U.S. The fact that Seattle-Tacoma has a container clause is of no relevance to the issue whatsoever, because it does, if they had exactly the same kind of clause that we have, the boxes that come into Vancouver would still come through Seattle and Tacoma and go to off-dock locations as they do today.
Go ahead from Mission. Go ahead from
Jack. I worked on the Vancouver waterfront for 15 years during the late 40s and early 50s, and one of the major reasons at that time for having containers happened to be the pilferage problem in Vancouver, which was touted to be about the second worst in North America outside of New York. Now, if this is true, why doesn't the government just get by and say, okay, let's get this container thing out of it and just leave these containers shut up totally so there is no more pilferage? And another question would
just
be,
Just a minute. What's our record now for pilferage?
I can't comment on that, Jack. I don't believe that pilferage at the Port of Vancouver is a major problem at this particular point in time.
Fair enough. Next call from Port Hardy. Go ahead from Port Hardy.
Yes, Mr. Purdy, I'm looking at this situation totally objectively, and for the good of the economy of the province, I see with the container clause adjusted about 500 people that drive trucks, many of them own their own rigs, hauling down to the States. Now, what would happen to them if we lost this container clause? They would be unemployed, hence the economy of BC would not be much better off, in fact, maybe a little worse.
Somebody is going to haul those containers to and from the Vancouver waterfront to the between Vancouver waterfront and the terminals that are now there. So that's going to make employment for truckers as well. Perhaps not quite as many. I would not like to comment on how many of the drivers that bring containers up from the States are actually Canadian and how many of them are American. But I know that if it comes through the Vancouver waterfront, every one of them will be Canadian.
Good point. Thank you very much. Go ahead, please.
Yes, I was wondering, why can't they offer competitive rates when our dollar is a lot cheaper than the American dollar?
Competitive rates for labor on the waterfront or competitive rates all across?
All competitive rates for labor and shipping costs, whatever.
We do have, as a matter of fact, the shipping lines serve the Trans-Pacific routes within the conference framework charge exactly the same rates for a box coming into Calgary, whether it comes through the Port of Vancouver or whether it comes through Seattle. There's a port equalization system. It's not so much a question of the cost as it is a question of the way in which the shipping lines actually carry out their business.
Yeah, but that still doesn't affect the freight forwarders in Vancouver who's shipping all the stuff through Seattle, does it?
No, it doesn't, because the freight forwarder does it for a reason of distributing the content of those boxes to a whole myriad of destinations across Canada, throughout the prairies, eastern Canada, and everything else. And he brings the boxes in, switches the cargo out, and creates a multiple number of units to be distributed throughout the rest of the country, and he gets efficiency within his framework of using that vehicle for distribution.
I see. Go ahead, please.
Yeah, I was wondering what Mr. Purdy thought, with the container clause being a problem, the states have the container clause, and the longshoremen in the states are paid more than the longshoremen in Vancouver, so wouldn't the problem seem to be in the facilities or the equipment used at the dock and not with the actual longshoremen?
There's no problem. We don't have a problem with the longshoremen. We have a problem with the terms of the contract that the longshoremen have with their management. And I'm not sure I clearly understand what the questioner is asking.
Well, this Seattle container clause is apparently under appeal from the NLRB or something. It doesn't operate, obviously, in the same way for Canadian shippers as the one operates in Vancouver for freight forwarders.
No, it doesn't. But the fact that the U.S. has a clause is irrelevant to Vancouver's problem.
Well, my thanks to Ray Purdy, Director of Port Promotion for the Vancouver Port Corporation. So it'll be 1st of September next year before this benighted de-stuffing clause is settled one way or the other.
Unfortunately, yes, that seems to be the case, Jack.
My thanks to all Ray Purdy. Oh, we'll be continuing this, maybe with a freight forwarding agent, too. We'll see how it blows up after the break, but not after this break. You kept the old woman alive for the last 10 years because she used to have to listen to you every day. Didn't know whether to kiss them or hit them.
Oh, wunderbar.
Wunderbar.
Uh-huh.
This is another of these interviews where I have to hide my Neanderthal chauvinistic reactions and pretend to be with it in every possible which way. Because the woman who's with me now, not a lady, she's a woman. I was always taught there are no gentlemen and ladies, just men and women. Really, is so well credentialed that I'm scared witless of her. She is Virginia Satir, doctor, world-acclaimed family therapist, author of People Making, is revered by her peers as the Columbus of family therapy, kind of like Jung or Freud, and yet she does things like tying people up with ropes to solve their family problems. Where do we start, Virginia? You're a family therapist.
Yes.
I wish I'd got to you earlier in my younger days. But what kind of family therapy do you do? I mean, are we going to talk about delinquents, druggies, alcohols, brutal parents, sex abuse, and all that litany of disgusting problems with which the human being is just afflicted?
Well, I'd like to talk about a variety of things. And one of them is the biggest thing that I discovered, and when I discovered it, it was wonderful. And that was that we could do away with the concept of blame and put in its stead consequences. I think those are two different things. And I've been in the field a long time, as we talked about before. And one of the things I saw a long time ago was how could people be in these knotty situations and still live in families? And then I began, first of all, to look at individuals. And then something would happen with the individual, and we'd go back to the family, and pretty soon some other kind of calamity would develop. This is back now 30 years that I'm talking. And then I discovered that a family is like a set of moving parts. And it's always acting, reacting, and interacting. And so when I say we look at things in terms of consequences rather than instead of blame, we look at how things move together with each other. And one of the biggest things that I came to look at was how what I call the architects of the family, the husband and wife, the father and mother, how they interacted, and then how that interaction got funneled down for the kids. And that became a very exciting, also, as you can imagine, a painful discovery.
But your therapy is to change that interacting accepted and successful means.
Mm-hmm.
And few people seem to have the answer to that. Most parents throw up their hands in horror and say, I can't cope with you anymore, go away. Right?
Yes. Well, you know, I had the advantage of going through the time of the hippie period, the flower children, so to speak. And I had an opportunity to see a lot of these young people whose parents were, what we should say, using the vernacular of that time, uptight. You know what I mean? And so these kids would come in, their long hair and their earrings and all the rest of that. And the parents, particularly the fathers, would be horrified, just horrifying. Well, you know, when I began to work with this, one of the things that I found out was that a very simple thing, that when father could tell son about how father was and how he looked at life, and how the kid could tell father how he looked at life, and we started out with just that kind of sharing and put the business about obedience on the side, fantastic things began to develop.
You mean communication?
Right.
Simple, straightforward talking.
Right.
On an equal level.
Right.
That's what's difficult for the older generation of any generation to accept, is it not?
Yes, it is.
But let's talk about the ordinary family. What are the secrets of bringing up, if you're a young couple with three kids, two boys and a girl, and they're 10, 11, and 12. Is there any real positive course of action you can take to prevent the disasters developing among the family?
Well, let me tell you two or three things. First of all, you know everything happens in a context.
Mm-hmm.
And I would like to start out by saying, if parents think they own their children, they're going to be in trouble.
Mm-hmm.
If instead they know that the parents are the only ways in which children come into the world, and they begin to be leaders to their children, not owners of their children, mm-hmm. and to be what I call empowering leaders, wise empowering leaders. And what does a wise empowering leader do? They look ahead to see what possibilities there that may confront somebody. They prepare people for those possibilities, and they don't get all involved in authority problems, because the authority comes out of the wisdom of what's going on in the teaching. And you know, another thing too with parents, not to mix up the idea of setting limits with wielding authority.
In other words, you will not say to your children, you will be in at 10 o'clock tonight or you're grounded for the next month.
I think that's a dangerous thing to do. Because you know what happens? The issue, whatever the issue is, gets missed. And what it is the question about authority that comes in. Who are you to tell me what to do? You know, this kind of thing. See, what's another thing I learned, Jack, which was very interesting. People sometimes think they're talking about an issue. And actually, the way they do it, they're talking about who's got the right to tell whom what to do. And any time that happens, you're going to have to get a resistance. You're going to have to get a defensiveness. And so the challenge is how can you get over working with the issue without activating these defensive responses?
Oh, this all sounds wonderful. You know, it's magnificent, and I understand it, in the perfect family. Because no family is perfect, as we well know.
Right.
But surely when you're rearing, if that's not a bad word, a young human animal, you must set some limits.
Oh, sure, absolutely. And you know what? I just developed a medallion. And the medallion has two sides. On one side, it says, in beautiful jewel letters, no. What you ask of me at this point doesn't fit, so the answer is no. Thank you for noticing. On the other side, it says, yes, in beautiful letters. What you ask of me at this point fits just fine. The answer is yes. Instead of, no, you can't do this. Or yes, this is. I can love you. Yes means I love you, and no means I
hate you.
That's right. And when we can begin to say that yes and no have to do with issues, then we can set really realistic limits. And that's been one of the real fantastic exercises that a lot of the families I work with have been grateful to receive.
You can simplify it to as simple as that.
Mm-hmm.
No and yes.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I don't know. But what about the real problem families?
Which ones are you talking about?
Well, the ones where the father's an alcoholic, they're on welfare, the mother's got a part-time job, there's one kid who's on the junk, and one kid who's smoking pot, and one girl who's started out as a hook in downtown Vancouver. There are some families you got to write off.
Well, let me tell you. See, I developed my career on the people nobody else wanted, the high-risk people. Let me tell you something, Mom. What popped in my mind when you were talking is you look at a tornado has passed through town, and everything is in shambles. I mean, the water doesn't work and all the rest of it. Okay. So now you look at that. And where do you start? See, the family you described is a tornado has passed through for a long time.
And there are scores of these families everywhere.
That's right. Now, so because there are so many, we have to take a look at what is the meaning of that. And for me, what I found out was that almost all these families where there was this tornado-like horror, really, that everybody in the family, no one in the family really felt good about themselves. Mm-hmm. I have taken people that have been on public welfare. I worked with them for 10 weeks, got them to start liking themselves. They began to get more awarenesses. They got in touch with their resources, and pretty soon they weren't on welfare anymore.
Mm-hmm.
So I know it can happen, but it doesn't happen overnight, and there are no panaceas. Because what does it take for somebody to go from a self-hatred position to a loving of self position?
Something good happening.
Yeah. Well, that's one piece.
What else does it take?
It takes a fact that one can really rely on oneself. One can have confidence in oneself.
Mm-hmm. And illness in the family is another terrible destruction of the family unit,
right.
Is it not?
Oh, yes, it is. And there are many...
Just before I go to the phones, is bringing up a family today with a much higher standard of affluence than, say, the 30s, with the all-pervasive television and the all-pervasive permissiveness of today, is it not 10 times as difficult as it was during the 30s?
Well, I think that it is. I think there is. I would add some other reasons for it, and that is that people today want more than what the people of the 30s did.
Expect more.
And they expect more, and there's more to be had on one level. But we haven't kept to date our ability to get what we need in terms of what there's there to be obtained.
I could talk to you forever, but I'm going to go to the phones and I'll be accused of selfishness.
Okay.
Virginia, by the way, is Dr. Satir. Is speaking at the ballroom of the Student Union Building. We've got a thing on it? Yeah. Parenting, Student Union Building, Thursday, 7 to 9:30 p.m. The phone number's there. Your calls to Dr. Virginia Satir on parenting. I'm perfect. I don't have to ask her any more questions after the break. You know, do you think kids are well enough armed today to stay away from cults?
Mm-mm.
What do you do?
No, I think that's...
How do you cope with that?
Well, that's again, for the cult business, how do you get into a cult? You have to feel very needy. And you have to feel it by the fact that somebody else is going to give you everything you want.
Mm-hmm. Even if they're going to use you as a kind of a slave along the way.
Yeah, but people don't know that at the beginning. And look how many people are willing to give away their power to somebody else in return for being taken care of.
Then we're back to your self-worth again.
Yeah, that's right.
Are we not?
That's right.
What about punks? Is this a bad thing, or should you let your youngster go through the punky behavior?
Well, you see, the way I look at it is that this age of adolescence, it seems like adolescents from time immemorial are experimenting with different things, and the tools and the toys are a little bit tougher than what they used to be.
That's right. Drugs especially. I mean, there were no drugs when I was a kid.
No, I didn't even know about them.
Go ahead to Virginia Satir.
Hello.
Go ahead.
Yes, good afternoon. Yes, Dr. Satir, I was just wondering, do you have any children yourself? And could you tell me what time their curfew hours and what time you wanted them in your home? And if they were out running the streets and doing B&Es and so forth and so forth?
Yes, I have children. They're all grown. I have two of them. And I will tell you what I did about the curfew business, because it was important for them to have some limits, okay? But the limits that I set with them, we set together, because we had the kind of relationship where we trusted each other. And so this always worked well.
You never went through a bad time with your own kids?
Oh, once in a while I would. But because we had trust, always my kids could comment on anything to me, it didn't matter what, so that I could always know what they were thinking and feeling, and I never violated their trust.
Good. Go ahead from Victoria.
Yes, Dr. Satir?
Yes.
I'm a little confused. You said a lot of problems get confused by a power struggle.
Uh-huh.
How do you respond when the problem is a power struggle?
Well, you know, it takes two people to continue a power struggle.
Mm-hmm.
And that is, let's say you make an attack on me, and that power struggle cannot continue unless I re-attack you.
Mm-hmm.
So one of the ways of starting is that if you're on the other end of it, you can stop working on the power struggle.
Mm-hmm.
You're saying in the old biblical fashion, turn the other cheek.
Not really, but at least don't respond in kind. What I do and what I help people to do is for them to be able to say, for instance, if you attack me, I say to someone, I hear you want something of me and I'm not sure what it is.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of hearing it, and I have a statement and I don't know what it'll mean to you, when we can respond to everything outside of ourselves as something to cope with rather than something that defines us, then what we can do is make a creative response to what's going on.
Something outside ourselves is something to cope with.
Rather than to define ourselves. So if a child or another person gives you a negative comment, that doesn't mean that's how you are.
Oh, I see what you mean.
That means that you now creatively cope with that. That's something outside of you.
Go ahead, please.
Hello, Dr. Satir. I realize you said that everything is based on context, but based on your experience, how would you find a family who is separated, it's deeply affected the children, and they get back together simply for the children? Based on your experience, do they find that the children can develop normally in a situation like this where happiness is sometimes has to be forced?
Well, let's look at it like this. First of all, let's remember that there are many, many aspects to things. And two parents who really have struggled with something and have deep concern for their children oftentimes will try to say, let's do this for our children, all right? However, they need also to make some new possibilities with them, because if they continue a war status or they continue a status of indifference, they're not doing much for the children. So that I think that it's only common sense that if you are living in a house with somebody, you develop some goodwill and some way of dealing with each other. So there's no pat answer for this.
But conversely, if a couple just go back for the sake of the children, perhaps the fact that four can live cheaper than two groups, is that bad for the children?
Well,
if there's continued enmity?
Of course it is.
Is a decision therefore sometimes got to be made to separate the family for the sake of the parents or for the sake of the children?
Sometimes both. Sometimes both.
And that's not necessarily a bad decision?
No. Nope.
But I would admire a couple who tried to get together for the sake of the children.
Well, then you see there are other things that have to happen. You cannot live in a state of enmity and succeed.
Mm-hmm. That's a good rule. Go ahead, please.
Hello.
Yes.
Am I on?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, I'd like to make a comment and a question, and then I'll hang up.
Right.
I'm a 30-year-old woman who's presently been in therapy for 2.5 years for being severely abused, and I appreciate your example of a tornado. I just wish the rest of my family could get involved in it. And I wholeheartedly support everything you're saying, because as I'm going through it myself right now, I can identify very strongly with what you are trying to get across. It's very difficult for me to kind of mention it, but it's really great what you're saying. The other thing is that what happens is, unfortunately, this type of therapy is only accessible to people who live in large centers like Vancouver. And is there a way for it to be spread throughout, or people in the interior be able to get a hold of it? Thank you. I'll hang up now.
Thank you. How do you get this kind of sympathetic therapy?
Well, let me tell you, I have thought about that for a long time. My books, people tell me, are helpful to them. And sometimes people just come together as groups, because I am in touch with a lot of areas all over the world, because my books are translated in at least 20 languages. And when there's nothing else, There are almost always people somewhere, nurses or somewhere, that have some possibilities. And if not, I've had people simply write me. I have drawers full of letters from people who have sat down and read my books and got some things from it.
Your book could be obtained in the public library in all possibility.
Oh, yes.
People Making by Virginia Satir. Published by SBB, whoever that is.
Science and Behavior.
I thought I'd just throw that in. Next call. Go ahead, please.
Yes, Dr. Satir. Just wanted you to comment on this, that perhaps the most cruel forms of abuse aren't necessarily physical, but they occur even in families where parents love the kids. And that one of the most important things for kids to grow up with is a sense of self-esteem, and for the parents to find out who their kids are and not to define for them who they really are.
I suppose that's your philosophy, isn't it?
Oh, it's very, very important. And you know what is one of the links? When you stop feeling that these are, quote, my kids, these are children within my care, and I need to come to know them. And it takes two things. The parent always has to be the leader for letting the children know who they are. And then the children, in turn, oftentimes can use this as a model. None of these things are easy. But can you see this vast difference between an adult who believes that the children are something that they should be?
How many families do you think, how many parents out of any given number actually can impress that on their mind, that these are not... you know, that these children are their own individuals and I must not attempt to dominate them?
Well, that's a new idea to many parents, I will tell you that.
Oh, sure is. To almost everybody listening, I should imagine. Go ahead, please.
Yes, Jack, just a comment and a question here. I was, I'm 37 years old and I've got a 15-year-old son now. And when I was his age, growing up with Webster on the radio in the morning. it was always, there was a lot of verbal abuse. Now, I'm in a situation now where I dropped out of school and I made good in my career and everything else, but now I'm trying to deal with my 15-year-old son coming home and saying, well, I'm tired of this, I don't want this, I want to go out and find a job. Well, with the way unemployment is everything now, I'm really against it, and it's causing a lot of friction in my house. And I would like the comments on this, and I'll hang up and listen to it, please.
Thank you. I hope the verbal abuse you got from your kid didn't come from me on the radio. Now, what do you do? There's a desperate father. He's got to try and convince his son there's no point in going out and get a job when he should be continuing his education.
Well, I look at it a different way. I look at it like this. I ask myself, if I've tried everything else, what can I lose by trying something else? Obviously, you have tried a lot of things. So at this moment in time, if you could give yourself permission to say, okay, now I'll try something else. And what will that something else be? To talk with your son and find out some areas where you and he can start to really connect with each other. And then to find out what are his hopes and dreams, and be able to tell him something about your hopes and dreams. Now that is much more difficult than it is for you to do it.
I've just scraped the surface with you tonight, Dr. Virginia Satir, but I'm on what they call in the business a hard count. Show that meeting notice again, will you, Pat? From up the top there, Thursday night at the Student Union Building. My grateful thanks to Dr. Virginia Satir, the people maker, right? And I hope you get thousands of people turning out to your lecture. New philosophies for me, too, and I'll be back after the break.
Thank you.
I'm standing outside the Astoria Hotel on East Hastings Street, home this past quarter of a century to the Astoria Boxing Club. And I'm going down to meet the men who are training for the fight of the century. Two little featherweights, once tall, once short. Tony Pep and Dale Walters for the brawl for it all this Thursday at the Agadome. It's a long while since I wended my way down into one of these gyms, I'll tell you. This is for the Canadian Featherweight Championship. I don't know if it means anything at all. Let's go find out. Okay, here's the man who's behind it all. Come on over here, Bruce Allen. I've always wanted to get you in the ring, right? Careful with that thing. Look, there's never been a big fight in Vancouver. Are you trying to pretend this is a fight of any great importance at all?
Well, there has been some big fights in Vancouver, Jack. I beg to differ with you. Muhammad Ali lost $1 million for Murray Pezum with George Chevallo. And then there was the Spinks-Ronaldo de Vera fight.
As a matter of fact, George Chevallo used to train here in the Astoria Sports Club.
That's right.
All right.
So what we're talking about, this ain't maybe a big fight at a world level, but I'm going to tell you one thing, Jack. This is a neighborhood fight. And you're from Glasgow, and you know a neighborhood fight.
I know a neighborhood fight. What's the purse for these two guys?
What's the purse? Top guys, Pep's guaranteed 10,000. Wallace is a 7,500.
How much for a ringside seat?
$30. You're sitting in one. You bought one.
I bought one?
You bought one.
You must have got hold of my credit card number. Now let's go inside and meet these fighters. How do I get in?
Lose weight. Where's Dale?
Now, here's Dale Walters, Canada's Golden Gloves bronze, Canadian Olympic bronze medalist. And you haven't fought that many professional fights, have you, Dale?
No, I've fought six, and I think they've all been pretty good stepping stones for me, though, Jack. I'm 6-0, so...
Featherweight, how are you on your weight? Are you close to 126?
I'll be underweight right now.
Underweight right now?
Yeah.
How tall are you?
5'6".
5'6"?
Yeah.
126 pounds?
Yeah.
How many knockouts have you had?
I just had one as a pro, and I didn't keep track as an amateur.
What the devil are you going into this brutal sport for? You know, you could... Have your brains knocked about mashed like Muhammad Ali?
Well, I think everybody's been put here for different reasons, Jack, and I've just happened to be a fighter, and it's been part of my life all the time, and this fight is something that has to happen. I can't walk away from it.
You know this guy, Tony Pep?
I do.
Tony, Tony, come on over. I want you to meet this little guy who's going to beat your head in. Knock your brains in. Come on in. Oh, you're going to stay outside the ring, are you? That's good enough. Shake hands and come out fighting. No handshakes? Did you call him a wimp?
Yeah, I did.
What did you say when he called you a wimp?
I don't have anything left to say to Tony Pep.
Nothing left to say at all. Listen, look at the height of you. How tall are you?
6'1".
How tall are you?
5'6".
Is this a fair fight?
Not really.
Why is it not really a fair fight?
Because he's got no chance, that's why. No chance whatsoever.
What's your weight?
129 about right now.
And you're 22?
Right.
How many professional fights have you had?
16.
How many have you won by a knockout?
Nine.
And you've been fighting since you were 7 years old?
No, not seven. 14.
Well, now, how about the reach problem? You've got a very short reach compared to his, right?
Yep.
What are your tactics going to be when you're up against him at the Agrodome on Thursday night?
His reach is only good if he can get me, and he ain't going to hit me.
You're dreaming.
Hey?
He's dreaming. He's crazy.
Have you ever fought before?
We've been in the ring once before.
What about you? You're a professional boxer. Have you ever made any... How much money are you going to get in this fight if you win it?
How much money do you get every week?
You mind your own business, darling.
I've been told not to discuss financial matters.
And you, too, have been told not to discuss financial matters.
I haven't been told not to discuss financial matters. I don't know how much I'm getting paid until we see how many people are in the stands.
Yeah, that's $30 for the ringside seat, Bruce?
Very, very good deal. It's a cheap fight for that. It's $30 ringside.
All right.
All sold out already, Jack.
Now, how about dropping this phony personal enmity and admitting to me that you're both good buddies?
There's nothing phony about it. He's been just talking a whole bunch of... just a whole bunch of...
A whole bunch of, as you say. This is a brawl for a doll deal.
That's right.
Now, if you get beaten, is this the end of your career?
I'm not talking about losing.
And you're very confident about it, because you've got no other career.
That's right. I've got a career in boxing, and then after I knock out Dale Walters, the career is just going to uplift.
I hope he walks into the ring with that attitude, because he's going to get a surprise.
You'll attend to him. Okay, don't shake hands, but put on a good fight the other night, but be careful you don't get injured.
Oh, no, I won't.
I won't.
All the best, Dale. All the best, Tony.
Thank you very much.
Doesn't seem right to me, 6'1" against 5 feet.
I'll knock him down to my size, Jack.
Oh, well,
you haven't knocked anyone down, man. One guy, a bantamweight.
Are you trying to separate them?
No. This is my grandmother. I want you to get them together. This is the last.
My grandmother hits harder than you.
I just feel so bad that you're
so
ugly.
About nothing, Chump, and I'm going to show you on the 20th.
You know that?
It's a joke.
Come on now. That's enough. It's all good feeling.
It's enough. Jack, this is the last thing I told Dale. I told Tony both of them. We've done a lot with the press. We've done a lot. These guys have seen enough of each other. It's going to be the next time they see each other. It's Thursday night. And that's it, because this is getting ridiculous. I don't want to get in the middle of this crap anymore.
But you're here to promote the fight. You know that perfectly well.
I'm here to make sure they don't hit you, Jack.
They wouldn't hit me. I'm too old. Okay, I'll see you at ringside Thursday night at the Agrodome. I'm not shaking hands with you. From the Astoria gym, thank you, and a very sweaty good night. I'll be back after the break. It was a tough fight, Mo, but I won. Tomorrow night, Howard Pawley, the Premier of Manitoba, who's in town for the First Minister's Conference, of which Prime Minister Mulroney and others will be attending in Vancouver this week. So it's Howard Pawley on the CF-18 caper. Tomorrow at 5 p.m. precisely, stay tuned for Tony and the News Hour.